Jonathan has some questions. Jonathan?
Jonathan?
You have some questions?
Questions? Yes.
Okay, I'll take a few questions which have been sent from the audience to Jonathan.
At the stage when the disciple can feel the sound current flowing, resonance, inside, outside the body, while meditating, should he be concentrating on the flow of current resonance in the body or meditating on listening to the sound current shabd? At initial stages of inner flying experience, it feels as if discipline is very little or no control on the flying. How to control the flying? Superman controls by moving his one hand forward in the direction of travel. Can we also use the same method, or is there any better method?
I repeat the question. It's a nice question. At the stage when the disciple can feel the sound current flowing, the resonance inside and outside the body, while meditating, should he be concentrating on the flow of current resonance or listening to the sound current? They are both the same. So he can continue to feel this resonance, the sound which is surrounding him, because that sound does become like a surround sound around you, that you are being surrounded by that sound. So being in that sound is as good as trying to listen to the sound. At initial stages of inner flying experience, it feels as if a discipline is very little or no control on the flying. How to control the flying? Put your arm forward. Lot of flying experiences that we have in meditation, especially flying at a later stage when you're totally unaware of the body, at that time there is not much option. It doesn't look like that you are using free will to fly, and that is normal. But if you plan before meditating how you will fly, that will work during flight. So you can direct yourself how you will fly later, that you have free will here, and you will fly accordingly. A lot of things that we decide here in the physical plane become automatic in the next plane. So that is why you make all the arrangements here. There was an Egyptian king, child king Tutankhamun. They find a lot of gold and other things around in his tomb, and they wondered why it was there. And the Egyptians have recorded that he wanted to take all that gold with him to the higher planes. And the Egyptians believed this world is very small, petty, and little time here. But the eternity, eternal life, will be very long. So whatever goodies they can collect here, they should take there. Now people make fun of those Egyptian pharaohs that they were thinking this gold will go with them. The truth is the gold did go with them. But they are looking at the material gold outside. Whatever they had planned as human beings, all their free will used during human beings became an automatic experience at the next higher level. So that is why if you want to fly in a particular way, in a particular direction, make your decision before starting meditation and you will fly it that way. So still in your choice, your hands.
These next two questions are closely related, so I'll combine them. The Bible speaks of an unforgivable sin in the book of Matthew, where Jesus said, "But the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven by men." What does this mean? Are there sins that perfect living masters never forgive? And the next is, do perfect living masters have opinions about morality, murder, suicide, abortion, sexual orientation?
The Bible speaks of an unforgivable sin in the book of Matthew, where Jesus said, but the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven men. What does this mean? Are there sins that perfect living masters never forgive? God does not forgive, but perfect living masters forgive. God is impartial. The God that we worship is not the totality of consciousness. The God we worship is the God that created this universe, the God that made all these things. He sits at the top of the astral plane, and that's the God we worship, because He made all things. He made the secret of the whole universe. He's the God who sits in heaven. He's a God who can be seen. He's a God, next to Him you can sit. And there are a lot of references even in the Bible about being able to go to heaven, sit near the God. But totality of consciousness has nothing except totality. There's nothing outside of it. And that is why perfect living masters, when they come here, they are not representing God or any gods. They are representing our own totality, the ultimate reality, reality beyond God, reality that created God. And therefore, when they appear in human form and they are talking from that level of consciousness, they always forgive. They never punish. They know we are being punished automatically by our own mind. They know we are being punished by the law of karma, which operates in the three regions, physical, astral, and causal. They know we are already being punished too much. They don't come to add punishment. They come to forgive. That is why one day a man came to Great Master. I was there. I saw this incident. A man comes and his secretaries are sitting on the floor next to Great Master. And the man runs to Master. Master, forgive me. You told me not to drink alcohol. You told me not to eat meat. You told me to live a very pure moral life. I defied your orders, all of them, last night. Bad company, I drank alcohol. I was able to eat meat which they gave me. I womanized all night. And this was my state. I want your forgiveness. Everybody was horrified to hear the story. Great Master said, okay, you are forgiven, don't do it again. He said, thank you, and he ran away. His secretaries and people around him, his close disciples, asked him, Master, this man committed sin. He committed heinous sins to go against your own instructions to him. And you just forgave him just because he asked, give me forgiveness, and you said, forgive me. He said, this man, Great Master said, this man was punishing himself. He had already punished himself before he came to me with his own mind. Now, I can't punish him more, so I forgave him and I told him, don't do it again. The secretary said, Master, supposing he does the same thing again and comes to you with the same prayer, will you forgive him again? He said, I think I'll forgive him again. Master, when will you punish him? He said, there are so many negative forces in this universe already punishing people. Don't put me amongst the punishers. Let me remain amongst the forgivers. The compassion and love of a perfect living master cannot be matched. They never punish, they always forgive. We punish ourselves, and therefore we should remember perfect living masters are not what he described as the punisher or the ruler of this world who rules, who's responsible for creating this law of karma, who is creating good and bad, who is creating good and evil. We are belonging to a place which is no good and evil. It's beyond this combination of opposites. We are in a state of bliss. Good and evil is created by the mind, played out by the mind. And we create good and evil with the mind, we reward ourselves and punish ourselves with the mind. So these laws of karma are all working only here. Soul has never had any karma, never will. The karma is carried by the mind. When you identify with the mind, then you begin to suffer the same karma. If you separate yourself from your mind and watch the mind at action, in action, you never have karma. You see some game going on, it will not affect you. So that is why the masters always forgive. Second part. Do perfect living masters have opinions about morality, murder, suicide, abortion, sexual orientation? Yes. Their opinion is, this is all mental. Rise above the mind, none of these will affect you. This is just something happening in a world of duality, world of pain and pleasure, world of opposites, world of good and evil, and it will stay here. You go to a true home, no such thing.
How do I stay stable, peaceful through the sorrows and joys of life I try, but external circumstances affect me deeply.
How do I stay stable, peaceful through the sorrows and joys of life? I try, but external circumstances affect me deeply. To be able to completely remain stable and calm at all times, you have to rise above the mind. So long as you are in the mental realm, even if you have been enlightened to reach heavens, even if you are enlightened to reach the universal mind, the causal mind, you can't be stable. The mind can pull you down even from there, and the mind will create conditions by which you will be pulled down by external circumstances. So if you want to have a true answer, how to be really stable and calm under all circumstances, no matter high or low, then you have to be above the mind and see mind operation as a game in front of you. There is a saying that if you want to be a true seeker, I'll say it in original Indian language and translate for you. Dukh, sukh, dono, samka, jano, or man, apmana. If you can do that, you are a true follower of this path. You should treat dukh, that is pain, and sukh, that is pleasure, take pain and pleasure with the same stride, as if they are two sides of the same coin. One is creating the other, and they both go together. And if somebody criticizes you, speaks ill of you, abuses you, or somebody praises you, take it both as the same. If you can do that, that's a stable mind. And this happens when you are above the mind, because the mind gets affected by these things. So the minimum one should get out of a spiritual experience, true spiritual experience, is to go above the mind and discover the soul, which has no karma, no ups and downs, and none of these questions arise there.
You talk about the five levels of consciousness, and then we also have the Hindu belief system of chakras. How does the five levels of consciousness correlate with the activation of chakras and the Kundalini? Thanks.
You talk about the five levels of consciousness, and then we also have the Hindu belief system of chakras. How does the five levels of consciousness correlate with the activation of chakras and the Kundalini? There are two experiences we have, which are built into us. One is called awareness, that we are aware of things. We know what they are. Second is called energy. Energy is an active part of awareness that sustains our body, sustains our organs, sustains our sense perceptions, and enables us to live in this world. In this physical body, there are centers like ganglions, like little areas in the body itself, which contains these areas of awareness and these areas of energy. The cutting line is the eye level. When they describe in the Hindu scriptures the six chakras, they're describing all the chakras below the eyes. When people practice meditation on the six chakras or the six centers of energy, they start from the eyes because they are awake. They start from their eyes and start going down the spine to the bottom. And they refer to this as a two-petaled lotus, just because they have two eyes. They have many of these so-called positioning of lotuses is because of the shape of the body organs. They call them the two-petaled lotus here. They go through the spine, which is like a house that we have. There's an elevator in the back, and then there are steps that you go through chakras one by one. They go back down to the bottom to the four-petaled lotus, which is at the rectum. They have a special chanting for that, so that they can awaken that and have a feeling that they can be having wish fulfillment. There are certain activities of energy, energetic experiences take place there. They rise to the genitals. They have different experiences there. They rise to the navel. They have different experiences there. They rise to the heart, another chakra. They have different experiences there. And all are required to be chanting different mantras from the scriptures for each of the centers. And above that is the Kant chakra, the throat, and then there are the eyes back. So they make a complete circuit. They go down, come stage by stage, and they reach the eyes and say, we have found, we are the ones. This is what we are. They started from where they did not know who they were. They go down, come back to the wakeful state and they are awake and they say, this is what we are. Very interesting experiences happen during this period. I tried these things for a few years. So that's why I can talk a little bit about them. The Kundalini is the reversal of energy which takes the energy from the second center of the genitals back toward the spine. And that awakening of the Kundalini, which could be likened to a physical experience of sex, could be in the meditation stage of the chakras, which arouses certain energies in you. Because they're connected with the spine, they open up a whole area of experience in addition to the experience of the chakra. So that awakening of the Kundalini, uncoiling of the Kundalini is really a function which can be performed as they do it on the second chakra of this. Also, the belief there is that the center of all these energies is in the center of the six chakras, which happens to be the heart. Because above that are the throat chakra and the eyes, below that the navel and two chakras below. These chakras are all about energy. Energy is a force that keeps things moving. These flows of energy are not visible. Medical doctor cannot see them, but they are experienced. We are all experiencing us. We are alive and kicking in our bodies because of these chakras running the energies. This system has nothing to do with higher awareness. Although we get experience of out-of-body experience, people who have practiced out-of-body experience from, say, from the heart chakra, it's the easiest to do it from the heart chakra in out-of-body experience through the energy cycles. Those who do that are still connected to the body through what they call a silver cord. There's some connection which they can't break. And they are afraid during that exercise, if that breaks, then they die. They're pulled back by the silver cord to physical body. It's a sub-astral experience in the energy centers. It's not even astral experience, not even an overlap experience of astral and physical. In fact, people made jokes of it. One man with his outer body tried to go into a revolving door and the silver cord got all blocked up. Now we talk of the five levels of awareness, which is quite different. Five levels of awareness is awakening to new levels. It is like awakening from a sleep dream. You awaken to a new level. And that level is divided like this. This is a physical level. And from the physical level of physical reality, which is wonderful, physical reality I consider in some ways higher than other higher realities, because here we have free will. There are only two entities that have real free will, a physical human being and the ultimate creative power. All others are following programs laid down by the ultimate creative power. And we don't have a real free will, because if we have real free will, we are defying that ultimate the power that decides all this. So the ultimate will is creating everything. Everything, every detail is pre-written from the top. But it comes down as if it is being written at different levels. For example, here somebody has a karma that he has to go somewhere and an accident is going to take place. The man goes to a holy person, says, I have been able to see myself and through very good astrologers who can predict that I am going to have an accident. Please help me, forgive me for my karma and help me to overcome. The holy man out of compassion says, all right, I forgive you. And he goes, accident is just averted. He thanks the holy man. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for helping me. Has he changed the karma? Looks like that. If he did not go to holy man himself, did not go to the place of accident, he could have said, I myself changed my karma. If he went to a holy man changed it, he says, holy man altered my karma. Then in meditation, he goes to the astral plane and looks up what was his karma. And he finds his karma was that he will feel he's going to have an accident, he'll go to a holy man, and holy man will say, okay, when was that written? From the beginning. So what the holy man did was also predicted, but not there, not here, not even at the astral plane till you saw what was written there. So the man meets his master there. Master, I find that was not real. Now I want you to completely change my karma. So, all right, all karma changed. And he says, very good, master, change my destiny. Ultimate destiny has changed. Then you go to the causal plane and sees the DVD, which set up his destiny for this life. He says that he will be having a little accident, which will be changed. He'll have this, and he'll go to the master and have everything wiped out, pre-written. So what looks like a change in destiny, as you go higher up, finds even the changes were all recorded beforehand. Ultimately, the entire thing on creation is totally the will of the ultimate consciousness. And we are having experiences of interferences, of how we think, how we decide things. That's just part of the experience. It does not mean that what physically happens is different and what we think in our head is different. In terms of destiny, they are the same. If destiny writes up what we will think, how we will decide, destiny also writes up all the physical events that take place. So the five levels of awareness are the physical level and some areas which come under the physical level, but they are not physical. They are part of what we call an overlap of physical and astral. An overlap means that you could be in a disembodied spirit, not having a physical body, and still see this universe. When people die in physical bodies, most of them are here for a while in that state. So they can see their relatives mourning, they can see what's going on with their own body, they can see burials and cremations of their body. They are very amused because they say, we can't tell these people that we are not dead. And we are still alive, we are watching you, but they can't see them. And sometimes they see very odd things, that the children who love them and the children who love them, as soon as they die, they are going into their pockets and looking at their notebooks. What can we get out of them? And they are still watching. These disembodied spirits, we are two kinds. In India, we call them as bhoot and pret. Both come under the category of ghosts. In the West, we just use one term, ghost or spirits. Bhoot are those who roam around. After death, they just roam around all over. Because they could not travel, they could not go to places, they just roam around. Or they were searching for something in their physical life, they could not find it. So they are roaming around looking for it in a disembodied spirit. The pret are those who are stuck at one place because of a murder, suicide, or these kind of unnatural deaths. They get stuck there. Now, how long these people roam around, or how long these people are stuck at one place, depends on another principle in the law of karma. And that principle is that when we are born as a human being, there's a notional life set up for us. A notional life in which we will have various events. And in the notional life, the event of unnatural death is also recorded, but there's also further life till the ultimate death of the body takes place. So what happens when the time comes for a certain event, unnatural death event? It happens, but we are still around here in this overlap of physical and astral till the time for the notional death comes up. So therefore, there's a timing for that. It's not that it's forever we are roaming around like that or stuck forever. It's for the remaining part of the notional life. This part of the law of karma, that it works like this. Then the astral plane, you can rise above the overlap and go into the pure astral plane. That's true awakefulness. Before that, you're not awake. You're having experience of flying. You're having experience of being out of the body. You've forgotten this body. You can do a lot of things, but you're still around in this universe, this world. When you go above the overlap, then you go into pure astral region. Overlap is a small part of the astral plane. Astral plane is huge, vast. Then you go into the higher plane, then you are awake and you find that you have another astral body completely of its own history, that it has its own life, not connected to the physical life. That physical life was a small part of that life. That during that astral life, you had several physical lives of different kinds. That astral life averages in terms of earth years, 1,000 to 3,000 years of earth time. So therefore, we have had one astral life, astral body and astral life in an astral world for much longer than we've had to the physical body. So So these are just trips to the physical self from that self. That's pure astral stage. Astral stage, our body consists of sense perceptions. That means all these sense perceptions, seeing, touching, tasting, smelling, are intact. But nothing else is intact. There's no matter. There's no flesh. But the feeling, the shape of this astral body is identical to this thing. And it carries the sense perception the same way when we are in a physical body that fits into this and makes those sense perceptions work as if they are part of the physical body. You separate them, they still work. So that's the stage when you discover that you are not a physical being at all. They are a dreamlike state. From there, you can meditate within that astral body. The third eye center of the astral body still has the eyes. When you do that, then you rise to a level which is the basis of all creation here. It's called the causal plane. That's a higher aware, a third level of awareness. In the causal plane, is the cause of all things. That's why you call it causal plane. It's the region where you have pure mind, no sense perceptions. The mind picks up all perceptions all at once. And the mind has the ability to absorb all information, all perceptions at once. They are split into different sense perceptions only when we go down to the astral and physical bodies. There you have no particular shape because there are no particular sense organs connected with the shape. It's only mind. So your mind is the causal body. The mind, just sense perceptions are the astral body. Mind itself, the thinking mind, is the causal body. And you are in that state of mental self, your own mental self alone, where that is where you pick up what kind of destiny you will have. That's a choice making, but it's a choice making of the soul entering into the universal mind. Fourth level is when you discover your own soul. You rise above the mind. Now, up to this causal level, one can go with one's effort. You can make an effort because all effort is mental. Whenever you say, I want to try, it's mental. Trying is always mental. So when you try hard under directions of a master who operates from universal mind on the causal plane, he makes you go through several meditation techniques. So you try and you reach there. Above that, there is no trying because there is no mind. So you can't try and go there. How can you possibly go? No seeker can go there unless he is pulled into that stage by somebody operating from beyond the mind. And that's where the role of perfect living masters comes in. What pulls you there is the same thing that pulls you here. It pulls you much stronger there than pulls you here. And that's the unconditional love of the master. Only love pulls you there because love exists beyond the mind. And all other things that we're talking about are within the mind. So when love pulls you there, for the first time you discover that you are an immortal soul. Everything else was mortal, even the mind, which is causal body, had a life term of 3 or 4 million or 5 million years, earth years. But there is no birth or death for that soul. It is always part of the totality. It's just experiencing individuation as a soul. And that is called beyond Brahma, Parabrahma. That means it's even beyond Brahma, the creative power of this universe. So when you are in Parabrahma, then you are in the place which is your first time you discover that you are in your true home, who you really are. First time you discover you are a unit of consciousness, the rest was an experience added on to you. But many masters, we call them perfect living masters, they come from that stage. Because once they make you realize who you are, which is self-realization, and we still call them perfect because they've gone beyond the imperfection of the mind. But the perfect living masters, which are still higher, are the ones who take you to totality. And they tell you, even the soul, that you are a separate soul is illusion. It's just an experience. Your reality is the totality. And it's within totality that you are like a soul. Now, this particular last stage was explained to me when I was very young, that the spiritual path consists of reaching the ocean, totality. And we are a drop of that ocean, separated from it. And we've been separated for so long, and we don't know how to go back. These masters come, and these holy people come, and they help us for the drop to fly back. With great difficulty, we fly back, and ultimately, we merge in the ocean. When I heard this concept of the spiritual path, I said, I'll never join it. For simple reason, if I have a drop, I have some identity. A drop, sun shines on me, I become like a rainbow. I have happiness in me. Look at the shining nature of a drop. And then they say, struggle hard to go back to an ocean and add a drop to the ocean and disappear. Merge in it. That means I lose everything. And the ocean gained nothing by one drop. It's called a lose-lose situation. This is not a spiritual path that I would follow. It was being described like that. It took me some years to discover this is not the truth. The truth is we are a drop of the ocean within the ocean right now. We never left the ocean. We left the awareness of the ocean. And what is a drop in an ocean, in a water? Here's a glass of water. I could also see drops of water. I can see it's full of drops of water. How big or small are they? I can make them as small with my awareness or as large as I like. So if I make one drop here, it's not left the glass, it's still there. And expand its awareness, it becomes big drop. Still the same drop that becomes bigger because it's already in the water. If it becomes the whole glass, still the same drop, it becomes the ocean. There's no way they describe it. They say, you are not a drop of the ocean, you are the ocean in a drop. But that's describing the same thing, that you have never been separated from it. That is your reality. You lost only the awareness. The spiritual path is not a path where you travel. It's not a path in that sense that you travel. It's a path of opening up your awareness to higher and higher awareness and discovering the truth. You are the ocean all the time. So it's very different from that. Now this makes sense to me. If I am the ocean, and I lost my awareness, I'd certainly like to get back to it. So the spiritual path made sense to me. So this is how we reach the final fifth stage of totality. And that's our true home, where we have an experience of the one and the many at the same time. And the drops are there. This is having experience, you know, this water. The drops are there, and the water is there. He said, right now it's having that experience. If I shake it more. In such kind, our true home, we are in a state of great bliss. We are in a state of total knowledge, total awareness, total knowledge, total bliss, total joy. No pain, no suffering, no opposites, no hells, no karma. None of these things. That's where we belong. As souls, that's our true home. That's where we belong. And these perfect living masters have come not to give us intermediate experiences, but to take us back there. They talk of a philosopher's stone. They say if a philosopher's stone touches iron, it becomes gold. Masters are not like that. They are philosopher's stone. When they touch iron, it becomes philosopher's stone. Masters do not come to make you advanced in something. They want to come to make you like themselves completely. And till that is done, their mission is not completed. And when they promise, we'll do this, they do it. They will not leave you no matter how long it takes. No matter how many lifetimes it takes. No matter how long you have to carry on the way. No matter how much you are distracted by more beautiful temptations and distractions that come in the astral plane. People are sometimes stuck for years there. Hundreds of years. Disciples of perfect living masters. And the master stays with them. And says, when you are fed up, we'll go ahead. No hurry. And we say, Master, why no hurry? Many people tell me, we are very impatient to get something. Why? Why are you impatient? You could be impatient if the home was very far away where you have to go. But you are sitting in the home. Where is the hurry? You just have to wake up one day and discover you are always there. So this is a game of awareness. The five levels of awareness have nothing to do with the five levels of energy. They control different things. One controls higher awareness and one controls, but the meeting point are the eyes. The inner journey to the higher plane starts from the eyes, goes backwards. They are similar petal, four petal lotus, six petal lotus, of which the energy centers are reflections. So similarly, there are as many as 12 chakras in the awareness plane, only six chakras in the energy plane. I remember an incident long, long ago, 1941, I think, 40 or 41. That's long ago. Many of you are not born. Great Master was invited by my uncle who lived in Karachi, Laos in Pakistan. port town, Karachi. He was working there as a meteorologist, weatherman. And my uncle was posted there as a meteorologist. He invited Great Master, come on the beach side, we'll have a great time. You'll have a great holiday on the beach. He loved the beach. So Great Master agreed. And about 10 or 12 of us traveled with Great Master by train to go to Karachi. Now my uncle and aunt, who lived in Karachi, used to go to a Swami, Swami Brahmananji. Swami Brahmananji used to teach yoga. He also used to give Ayurvedic medicines. So since my uncle and aunt were already disciples of Sanghis, of Great Master, they used to go to this Swamiji for the medicines, the Ayurvedic medicines. And he was a very bright guy, eyes sharp, eyes little dark skin. He used to wear a little turban, orange-colored, saffron-colored turban, saffron-colored dress. And he used to have a little muffler kind of thing around his neck, which he used to hold when he walked. With great stateliness, you know, how he walked. And I still remember very clearly that Swami. So when Great Master reached and lived in the house of my uncle and aunt, they said, we should invite Swamiji to meet you. So they went to Swamiji. Swamiji, our master has come from a Dera, far away. We would like you to go and have his darshan. Swamiji said, yes, bring him along. I'll give him my blessings. And that's what they went for. Now, they didn't know what to do. So they had to find some way to satisfy the Swamiji and still bring him to Great Master. So they decided to have a lunch and invite Swamiji to the lunch. And Great Master was already staying there. So they had a two-seater love seat. So they said, we'll put both of them together here. So when Swamiji came, they made him sit on that. Great Master was in the bedroom. They went to him, they said, Master, Swamiji has come, who we talk about, Brahmananji, and he's in the living room. Great Master, I'll come and see. So Great Master came, and he sat next to Swamiji and put his hands like this and bowed. And Swamiji put his hand on him. I bless you. I watched the scene. We all watched. What's going on here? We thought we were getting some darshan for Swamiji, but this is the reverse taking place. Swamiji is giving blessings to Great Master. And Great Master said, thank you very much. Then Great Master said, in his little voice, Swamiji, what a pity that all these Swamis, Yogis, they are all talking of six chakras as if it is enlightenment. They are not even aware of the 18 chakras. They don't know the 12 spiritual chakras. Swamiji turned to him, says, Master, what are you talking about? I never heard these 18 chakras. Where are these 18 chakras? Great Master said, six chakras are of energy below the eyes, which these people practice. And 12 chakras are of Anda, Brahmanda, and Sachkanda. There are 12 chakras ahead. And Swamiji said, I never heard of them. Can you please explain in some more detail where these 12 chakras are? Great Master said, you know, I am on a short visit here. If you happen to come to my Dera, I'll certainly explain fully to you about the 12 chakras. So the dinner, our lunch was served. Swamiji went back. Swamiji could not sleep all night. Next morning, he called my uncle. He came over, said, I can't sleep. I am wondering about these 12 chakras now. Where are these 12 chakras? Anyway, he left, came back to the Dera. Swamiji told all his disciples, he had a group of disciples who used to come for yoga training to him. He said, goodbye, I am leaving. I am going to a place where I am going to learn about 12 chakras now. So, goodbye. And he came to the Dera. When he came, Great Master instructed that he be given VVIP treatment. He be put down in the best guest house in the Dera. And there should be servants around him all the time, serving him. Best food should be served to him. And he will be at liberty to come and see me anytime 24/7. So All this was conveyed to Swamiji, it went very good. That he's a VVIP, he's a special guest here. Then great master said, Swamiji will sit next to me when I give my discourse. So next day, great master sitting, Swamiji sitting next to him. And great master saying, these yogis and Swami, they are all caught up in this thing. They should rise above into the centers of awareness. And Swami is looking like this. After 2 days, he said, Master, I have a little problem. Great Master says, what is your problem, Swamiji? My problem is, when you are speaking, I want to look at you. And I have to turn my head like this. I got a pain in my neck. Oh, Great Master says, I also observed that. No. You should sit in front. So from the stage, Swamiji went down. But they were given a small chair. There used to be small chairs for those who couldn't sit on the floor. So Swamiji sat on the chair. He heard 2 more discourses and said, Master, I have a problem. Now, Swamiji, what is the problem? Now the problem is you sit high on the stage. I sit right in the bottom. I have to keep my head up like this. And I've got a pain in my neck. So, Great Master said, I noticed also that. Please move his chair 30 feet behind. So the chair of Swamiji was moved 30 feet behind in the center. 2 more days went. He came to Master. Master, I am having a little problem. What is the problem now, Swamiji? The problem is that when I sit in the chair, people behind me can't see you. I feel very guilty. So Great Master said, I also noticed that. Remove the chair. After a while, Swamiji was stuck way behind other people. He said, but Great Master said, I can see him 24/7. So he went to test it out at 12 o'clock at night. And he said, I want to see Great Master. Instructions were, he can come anytime. So the doorman said, welcome, Swamiji. Went and woke up Great Master. Great Master, Swamiji, I'm very happy to see you. What can I do for you? No, I was just seeing if I can have your darshan in the middle of the night. Okay, Swamiji, go and do meditation. Swamiji went away. Then Great Master set up a little place of Ayurvedic clinic for him in the Dera. So he could sit there. At that time, I was just trying to learn and practice homeopathy. So I had also a little hut next to him. So we used to exchange notes. One day I was sitting with him. This is after a few months, 3-4 months. He's telling me, Swamiji told me, your master is a great diplomat. I said, why? He said, first he brings me in and puts me up as VVIP. Puts me in the best place. Now I am to sleeping in my little hut. And then he makes me say, you can meet anytime. Now I have to stand in line with all of everybody. I am just an ordinary person now. And then he gave me special food. Now I have to go to the langar and eat ordinary chapati and dal. What has he done to me? Had he done these things when I came, I would have gone back. But he was so clever. He trapped me by doing this. And now I am trapped by his love. I can go nowhere. An example of a Swami. Then, of course, he learnt about awareness, and he did good meditation also. And he was very strong that way. He already had so much power to concentrate his attention that he was able to get good results very quickly after that. So that is why the differences between the energy centers that we practice are for some other purpose, and the awareness is for another purpose. For people who want to enjoy life in this world, and there's so many of us who think we should try to get the best, they need not come to this spiritual path of the higher awareness. This path that I am talking of, the teachings of this great master, are for those who really want to go to their true home, who really want to go beyond their minds, who are afflicted by their minds, who are troubled by their minds, who have realized the mind is responsible for their misfortunes, who have suddenly discovered that the mind is creating horrible thoughts in your head. These are the kind of people who come to Perfect Living Masters and seek something higher than that. I think I covered a lot of ground in the question now. Any more questions? One more. There is one more? Okay.
As many as you say, and more after that.
If you are confronted with a potentially life-changing decision to make. How do you know if the decision you make is that of the divine? Thank you.
If you are confronted with a life, potentially life-changing decision to make, how do you know if the decision you make is that of the divine? If you think about it and make a decision, it's your mind decision. If you don't, it's divine. If it comes to you intuitively, it's divine. If you have to think about it, it's your mind. That is why we all have to make decisions all the time in our life. And if we decide intuitively, it's decision is divine. If we decide by thinking, maybe 50% right, 50% wrong, sometimes 40% right, sometimes totally wrong. Mental decisions are like that. So that is why the divine appears to us through intuition. And I must tell you another thing. Those who cannot see the divine cannot even see what part of their decision is intuitive. For them, there's another sign that most of these intuitive experiences you have are followed by external coincidences. For example, you have a question in your head, how to decide? How to decide whether to go to hospital for something or not? And driving, there's a billboard saying, new hospital. Where is this hospital sign come? I never saw it before. Or you open a book and it says illness. What is there? How is this word coming up? It's connected with what I was trying to decide. So intuitive experiences are also supplemented by external coincidences. If you are on a spiritual path and your love and devotion for a master or for God in the form of that human being is growing, more coincidences take place and more intuitive flashes come to you. I've seen this in every case happening. So these are signs that the divine is operating through intuition in you. Maulana Rumi, Jalaluddin Rumi, in one of his Masnavis, in one of his poems, asked this question. He says, people ask me, what is God's will? And what is your will? Are they two different wills? Isn't everything God's will? Then why are we distinguishing and saying we should live in God's will? He says, it's very simple. If God has given you a spade in your hand, he has expressed his will, dig. If God has given a pen in your hand, he has expressed his will, write. If circumstances are telling you what to do, you didn't make them up. God is telling you what to do. So when these coincidences happen and when the intuitive hunch in you, in the gut feeling in you matches that, there's clearly a divine message for you. And you follow it. Okay, I'm very happy that I could answer some of your questions today. And I know there are a lot of people waiting for interviews starting at 4 o'clock. So I'll take your leave today. Tomorrow is the great Master Bhandara. I welcome you to this very great event, which I have considered one of the great events of my life. And these events are also a repeatable event. Every year we have it. I'm very happy. Another event is initiation by your great master, which is the greatest day of my life. I realized late, but I realized it. That the greatest day was the day I was initiated by him, because I didn't know what initiation was fully till much later. When I discovered initiation is a divine promise. It's a guaranteed promise. And it is not a guaranteed promise that when you die afterward, you will see what happens. It's a guaranteed promise that you can verify while you're still sitting in your body. It's a guaranteed promise you will know what will happen after this death while you're sitting in the body. It's a guaranteed promise where you will go eventually, which can be verified, tested through meditation right while you're here. That made great sense to me. I like something that can be verified by personal experience. And that is why, to all you friends, I recommend, please, take slow steps, small steps. The spiritual path can be somewhat dangerous also, if unguided. If you meditate unguided, you can go into territories which are painful and like hell. Hell is also an internal experience, that you can go to hell. there was a bibi who was serving great master, and one day she was crying. Her little house was next to our house in the Dera. We heard her crying. Everybody gathered and tried to open the door. As we broke open the door, Bibi was crying loudly. So we tried to stop her, we tried to talk to her, she couldn't hear anybody. Just howling. So, and we knew she's a very advanced Bibi, who does a lot of meditation. So why is she crying? So we went to Great Master and brought him. And he came to see the lady and he said, Bibi, why are you crying? She said, I am in hell. How did you go to hell? I just out of curiosity. I was just in early stage in my meditation. I just happened to say, let me see what it means. Are they hurting you? Is anybody harming you? No. Then why are you crying? I am crying. I can't see what they are doing to others. It's great punishment going on. They're burning people. They are doing this. She described some very horrible scenes that she was actually witnessing. Great Master said, do your similar. Repeat the words I gave you. They'll pull you out. I've forgotten the words. There's so much suffering here. The great master said, can you hear my voice? He said, yes, I can hear your voice. Come along this voice. Follow my voice. And she opened her eyes, put her head on the great master's feet and said, he said to others present, including myself, don't think that unguided meditation always takes you to higher places. These so-called places of punishment and hell are also in the astral plane. They are part of that. Heavens and hells, both are there. These are still regions of duality, of opposites. And therefore, if you want to meditate, go right again. Best thing is to go strictly with your master till you find his inner form, the radiant form of the master. And then travel anywhere you like with the master, not by yourself. So this is a good caution for those who are impatient to go. There's another friend of mine lived in the East Coast. And she said, I don't want to wait. I want to see at least, the causal plane what it is. And for a few moments, she had experience. She broke down completely. She said, I saw that everybody is being made up there. Like they are just building blocks. And I thought they are real people. I thought they are real people with whom I had great relationships. They are just being made up like that. It was almost a psychological breakdown. It took a long time for her to recover fully what happened. So if you make a leap into these areas, if they are so different from your assumptions about reality, that they can shock you. But if you go step by step, little experience today, little more tomorrow, you will not have this shock. And be guided by masters. And don't do it on your own. Thank you very much. I'll see you tomorrow.